there are millions upon millions of Americans who have at least a sense of the experience as a buyer from Amazon. Give us a sense of the perspective of a seller going through Amazon. What are the implications for a seller of, I don't know, you pick the product. I mean, we're sporting goods you spoke about. I mean, give us a sense of what the experience is depending on how you're positioned as a seller.
Yeah, well, first of all, I would say that the choice of whether to be a seller or not is, you know, increasingly not really a choice. I mean, the thing that I think is really astonishing about Amazon is that most people are starting their shopping on Amazon. It used to be even just a few years ago that people, when they wanted to shop online, they would go to a search engine like Google and put in the name of the product, and then they would get, you know, different companies would come up, you know, including Amazon, but also others. Now, a majority of people, and this is largely because of the Prime program, a majority of people now start their shopping right at Amazon. And what that's meant for all of these other retailers and manufacturers, you know, anyone who wants to reach consumers online, they no longer have as much traffic that potentially could come to their own website. And so they're really in this, they have this sort of Faustian choice. You know, they have to decide whether to continue going it alone with their own website, kind of hanging their shingle out on this road that's less and less traveled, or deciding to become a seller on a platform that is operated by their most ferocious competitor. That's where the traffic is. But once you become a seller on Amazon's platform, you're turning over to Amazon your customers, your product knowledge, everything that you do is accessible to them. And there's a lot of, you know, there's a lot of reporting and also studies that show that Amazon uses what it gleans from sellers in order to compete against them. So we know, for example, from a Harvard Business Review study that once a seller comes onto the platform, Amazon tracks their transactions, and within a few weeks is selling that seller's most popular items itself. So Amazon brings those popular items into its own inventory and may, in fact, give itself, you know, top ranking in the search results. We know Amazon continues to raise fees.
Stacy, I just want to stop there and just sort of you know, make that a little bit more concrete for people, because it really is amazing. So if I go on and I've got a line of shoes, I guess, right? I mean, or I'm a shoe seller, and some type of sneaker is selling extensively. They will then find another supplier and they'll promote that sneaker above my selling it. If people search for it, is that basically the way it works?
Yeah, they give themselves what's known as the buy box. You know, that's the default seller for a particular product. So if you think about it, as an independent retailer, let's say you have a sporting goods shop, you have a running shoe store, and, you know, you've been in this your whole life. You're a runner. You're just deeply into this sport and know everything about it, know all the suppliers. And so when there is a new innovation in running shoes or some other piece of equipment, you're right onto it, right? You know about it early, you recognize its value, and you go out and you start selling it. Now you've given that knowledge to Amazon. Amazon says, hey, there's this new thing, this new sneaker, this new piece of equipment that's selling really well. Let's just bring that into our own inventory, and we'll just give ourselves the buy box. And we'll start taking, you know, suddenly you were doing pretty well selling this sneaker on Amazon, and now, you know, 90% of the sales have been wiped out because you're no longer the default seller for that item, Amazon is. And, you know, Amazon uses this information that it gets from sellers in all kinds of ways to compete against them. You know, another way that this is happening is that Amazon is increasingly manufacturing the goods that it sells. It now manufactures all kinds of things, from batteries to baby wipes. It has a huge apparel division. Amazon is now the largest seller of apparel, and it's rapidly becoming one of the largest manufacturers of apparel. Sells it all under all different kinds of brand names, not necessarily, you know, Amazon branded apparel, but other brand names. And what we're seeing is that Amazon is doing knockoffs. You know, so there was a case of a company out in the Bay Area that made these really innovative laptop stands. There are these kind of cool C-shaped stand, your metal stand for your laptop. They built up a nice small business, but a nice business, doing sales of these items on Amazon. Got up one morning and lo and behold, the first, you know, they used to be ranked first in the search results. Instead, it's Amazon laptop stands that look exactly like theirs, but instead have the Amazon smile, arrow smile thing, logo on them instead of their own logo. So this is really, I mean, this is, you know, really gets to the crux of what the concern is about Amazon and why this is an antitrust issue, which is you essentially have a company that owns the pipelines, owns the rails, if you will, that other companies need to get to market. And it uses that power in ways that undermine competition.
And let's just, you know, be clear on how this was established, right? I mean, because, I guess it's bearing on, you know, antitrust questions. It's not really the issue as to whether or not other people could or could not have done this in the first place. That's largely irrelevant. I mean, it was going to be somebody. But what was the mechanism in which they developed essentially this railroad? Because, you know, once you have one railroad, it's much harder to get the rest, right? I guess because towns build up along those tracks and presumably it covers certain grounds that you can't build other places. Like, they basically did it by through books.
Yeah. I mean, Amazon got to where it is in part because it used tactics that in another era we would have policed as being, you know, anti-competitive, that antitrust officials would have gone after. But we've been living in this kind of relaxed era of antitrust. And so Amazon grew in part by using certain tactics that are technically illegal, but we don't really enforce anymore. So one of them is that it lost a lot of money selling goods below cost. And books, as you note, is the first area where Amazon did this. You know, early on, Amazon, when it was just a book retailer, it sold books at a loss, like less than it paid for those books. And in its first 6 years in business, Amazon lost $3 billion selling goods below cost. Investors were fine with that. They were happy to sort of float that, those losses with this anticipation that Amazon was eventually going to own the book industry. And that's exactly what came to pass. You know, all of these bookstores closed, borders disappeared, publishers really shrunk. Today, Amazon sells 70% of ebooks. They have half of all books, including, you know, print and digital books. And they, you know, a huge number of the books that are on the Kindle bestseller list are also published by Amazon. So they now dominate the book industry. And we've seen them use this below cost selling in one sector after another. They also use it really strategically to go after potential new competitors. So, you know, you had a company, for example, a number of years ago, Zappos, you know, which is an online shoe retailer. You know, around 2007 or so, you know, Zappos was really attracting a lot of customers. People really liked what they offered. Amazon tried to buy the company, and the founder said, no, we don't want to sell. So Amazon proceeded to sell shoes at a loss. They lost about $150 million selling shoes at a loss. Zappos being, you know, a smaller company without those deep pockets, you know, bleeding red, and finally just couldn't, you know, they tried to match Amazon's prices, they lost all this money, and finally they gave up, and they sold to Amazon. So Zappos is now Amazon. We've seen Amazon do this with other upstart competitors, you know, sort of use its financial might to knock them out of the market or and to buy them up in the process. So part of how they got here is through that, is through tactics that, again, really should have been policed for antitrust concerns.
All right, Stacy, we got to take a break. And when we come back, I want to talk more about what Amazon is attempting to do here and if there's what the mechanism and the solution to why it's problematic and what the solutions could very well be. Talking to Stacy Mitchell on her piece in The Nation magazine, Amazon doesn't just want to dominate the market, it wants to become the market. I'm Sam Cedar. This is Ring of Fire Radio. We'll be right back.